हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज मूल शंकर कोठारी। थैंक यू ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर जॉइनिंग अस टुडे। टुडे इज द फर्स्ट सेशन फॉर आवर प्रिपरेशन फॉर CHFA सर्टिफिकेशन, द हाइपोलॉजी फैब्रिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन सर्टिफिकेशन। एंड दिस इज द दिस इज हेयर इज द डिटेल ऑफ दिस सर्टिफिकेशंस दिस सर्टिफिकेशन एंड I will be starting with application life cycle management. That is the 20% of the exam. So I will start with install and initiate the chain code package as certifications based on 1.4.1. So there is a difference between 1.4 and 2.x. So there is a bit difference of chain code life cycle. So we will be focusing only on 1.4 because we have to. We are planning for certification, and currently certification is on 1.4. Then we will see that how we can define the endorsement policy, the policies. We will in my last session. I have define the private data, how we can create the collection policy for the private data, and how, that was from the developer perspective. So now today we will see with regard that how admin will be defining the collection policy, and we will modify and upgrade the chain code. As we know that during the exam we will have access on the documentation for this 1.4. So I haven't prepared any presentation for this session. So we will be only it's better that we should see what exactly on the documentation. Even we will be able to see the commands, and we can copy paste the commands, and we can shoot those commands on the terminal during the examination. So I will be using this documentation so that we can see the theory first, then I will be doing the practical work. So as we all know that chain code is as I always say that is the bread and butter of blockchain technology. So typically it handles the business logic agreed by the members of the network. So we, whatever the business logic, whatever the requirement we have, we always write in the chain code. Whatever the language you use, either it's Go, Node.js or Java, whatever language you select, as we know that Go is a default language. So I always prefer Go, and I mentioned in my previous presentations also, for a smart contract, you can go and check on Hyperledger YouTube channel. It's uploaded there. Excuse me, give me a moment. I have someone outside. So whatever the logic we define, it's inside the chain code. So it's done by the developer of Hyperledger developer. So whatever the so being an administrator, what are the tasks we perform being an administrator? There is a chain code life cycle consists of there are we have to install the chain code, we have to initiate the chain code, and we have to upgrade the chain code. So we will being we will see this today's topic in as a administrator, what task what and how we will perform the task, and these tasks will be given during our examination. So we will see that what is the life cycle of the chain code. Chain code basically there are four there are four steps we perform for the chain code. We create the package, then we install the chain code, and then we as we know that we have to initiate for the first time we have to initiate the chain code. Then if it's required, then we have to upgrade the chain code. So these are the four this is the life cycle of the chain code. So we will see the theory that that interaction with the various nodes in the blockchain network, peers and endorser, it allows one to package, install and initiate the chain code. And if required, we have to upgrade the chain code on the endorsing peer. So if we go that before we were practicing, we were not creating the package as it is a requirement of the, we were directly, it's not important that we create the package and we install, let me mute someone. There is a, okay. So it's not always required, but there are, I will explain that what is the importance of packaging here. So previously what we were doing, we were directly installing the chain code, then we were initiating the chain code. So today we will see what exactly the packaging is and what benefits it provide to us. So basically packaging consists of, chain code packaging consists of three parts. In the first part, we define the chain code deployment specification. This consists of the name of the chain code, version, and the path of the chain code, where exactly the, this is what we were giving in the installation also. So we will define that this is my chain code name, here is the path, and what exactly the version, it is 1.1, whatever format we want for the versioning. So we will be in the first part, we will be defining the chain code deployment specification, or we call it CDS. It is also called CDS. So this is the first part. In the second part, that is the optional part. It's an optional part. We provide the instantiation policy that who can, in the package, we define that who can initiate this chain code. So this is optional. If we are not providing any policy, so it's okay. But we can say that this is the initiation policy that ABC, but maybe we can say the organization one admin can initiate the chain code. Only that user will be able to initiate. No, if we have defined this packaging, so we will see that. How it works. Then we also have to, there is a, that who is the owner of this chain code. If we want to define that who is the owner, in the third part, we define that who is the owner of the chain code. There can be the multiple owner for this chain code, maybe organization one, organization two, both can be the owner. So what, whoever the owner of the chain code, we define in the chain code. During the chain code packaging, so this signature basically establish the ownership. As I mentioned, told you that it is establish the ownership of the chain code. It allows the verifications of the content of the package and to detect the package tampering. This basically, this packaging helps us to provide it is providing us the security so that we can detect the package tampering. Only the authorized person which we have defined in the initiation policy will be able to initiate only. So here is the security part that we can also. It gives us a policy so that we can detect the only, as we know that only the authorized member will be able to initiate. So we will have a much control for this. So this is how we came. This is how the packaging help. So we do before installation, we create the package. There are two approaches. It's defined that we can package it. There are two approaches to packaging the chain code. One for when you have multiple owner of the chain code, hence we have to chain code package signed by the multiple identity. Basically, if you see that in 2.0, there are so many, it's much more mature, or you can say it's more enhanced than packaging and this than here in 1.4. But we have to just see that this is how. If we focus on the exam. So we have to see that how this can be done and how packaging help that how packaging help us to and how we can do it. So if you see here that command that I let me copy here. In the it's we create that peer chain code package. We give the name of the as I mentioned that we in the CDS chain code deployment specification we have to give the name of the chain code which we were giving also in the installation. We need to give the path of the chain code wherever the our chain code resides. Then we have to give the version of the chain code. This is the first part that we have to have provide this we have to provide this that this is the specification, this is the version of the chain code. Then I will come this on the later. Then I as I mentioned that this is the optional that initiation of the chain code. So here we are defined that admin of organization one will be admin of organization one will be initiating this chain code. So as we have defined here, so only organization one admin can initiate this. And the last part is we are creating the package, whatever the name you want to give of the package. So you will be using later. So we will be giving. Now let's come to the here it is one more we have to give that this is for the ownership. We have to give the minus small s and minus capital S. We see the detail that the minus s small s create option creates a package that can be signed by multiple owners. Simply creating a raw CDS means it's a if we specify minus s we have to provide minus capital S must be provided if other owners are going to sign. We will not go into much detail. So we have to say that for this ownership, we have to give, if we want to sign this package, so we have to provide these two minus small s, minus capital S. This is define the ownership. So I will not go in much detail. So minus, if we see the, you can go and watch this documentation. I will be sharing the link. So you can go and see. If we are not providing this, if we minus options, if we are not giving this ownership, so by default, what will be happening? Whatever defined in the local MSP ID, in the core.yml file, so it will be automatically assigning this ownership that this is whatever the value is in local MSP ID, it will be assigning at the time of the, it will automatically give the signing that whatever the local MSP ID it will take from there and it will take the value of this owner from local MSP ID. So you can check that how we can have a multiple owner. For now I will be link. So I will just give the idea that this is how we can define the ownership and this value is automatically taken from the local MSP ID. As this is optional initiation policy. So we will be seeing that who is authorized to initiate the policy. If you see there, it is almost same like it is same like a policy we endorsement policy we define in the at the time of the instantiation. So it is same policy. So let's dive that how we can define the policies. So let's go let's see that how in the second part if you go the exam that we have to before going to install initiate the package. So we need to see that how we can configure the policy. We might they might assign us the task that you have to define this policy. So we will see that how we can configure the endorsement policy. So let's this is a very good link that how we can define the endorsement policy before going to do the practical work. So every chain code has an endorsement policy, whatever the set of the peer channel that must execute the change code and endorse the execution result. Basically when as we know that in it's in Hyperledger Fabric, somebody has to endorse, somebody has to validate the transaction, that whether whatever the transaction is coming, so whatever the transaction, it must be endorsed by someone. Whatever the policy we define, if we are not defining, then by default policy will be applied that is defined in the core file. So if I see that there are three ways we can define the policies. Let me go to exactly to the syntax. That we can say that we can define 3 to 4 ways there. We can define that we will be focusing that if it's and or are out of policy. I haven't checked this one, if anybody means this E policy, if you but I will be explaining this one. Suppose if they ask that we have to define the endorsement policy that organization one, member of organization one, member of organization two, and member of organization three, one member of each organization should endorse this transaction. So in this way, so how we will be defining, we have to say that and means and, as we all know that and means all of these should, member of all of these organizations should endorse the policies, endorse this transaction, otherwise transaction will not be validated, transaction will not be validated. So if this is the case, then we will be defining. If suppose they ask that you have to define the endorsement policy like organization one and organization, member of organization one and organization two must sign this policy. So what we will be doing, we will be providing and organization one, organization two. If they ask organization three also, so we have to define the, with the and policy. So this is the and policy. And if you see that there are different, it can be, there are different, we can define that whether it can be the, like I may show you that organization one dot admin, if we say that only the administrator, suppose there is a special chain code that we want that only the admin should endorse this, so we can define that organization one, organization zero dot admin. If it can be member, any member of organization one, so we will be just, these are the valid principle that we can define that if say that any client of organization one should endorse this, so we have to, we will take organization one, org one dot client, any client of organization one. And if we say that any pair of organization one, so these are these valid principle. So we will be defined that, suppose they say that any member of organization one or two, so we will be, so we definitely we will not go with the policy. So we will not definitely go with the end, so we will be saying that our organization one, organization two. So any member of as we know that in its logical operator, so any member will endorse this transaction. If this is a policy is defined, so any, suppose organization one dot member, any member of organization one has endorsed this, validated this transaction, so it will not wait for other members because it's already it matched the policy, and it is as the policy is validated, so it will go further and it will commit the transaction. So suppose if they ask that either member one, organization one, or we can define the policy, endorsement policy also like this, member of organization one or one of the member means our organization one or both of these should validate. Suppose organization one is the main organization, we want that if organization one endorse, our organization two and organization three members should if suppose only the organization two member has endorsed the policy, organization one has not endorsed yet, or so this will wait for either organization three dot member means a member of organization three, or so this is how we can match. I hope it is clear for you guys. Any question? Are you getting my points? Is it clear?
Hi.
Hello.
Hi. This is pretty clear, and I think you're doing a great explanation. Maybe you're going to speak about this, but I'm going to ask now, and then you can later answer if it's necessary.
Sure.
But in a practical way, how can we collect the signatures? Because this is the policy, right? Mm-hmm. You can define the policy, but furthermore, we need to have a mechanism to get signatures from participants in a consortium. So if you can talk about this now or later.
Okay, I will try to cover at the end of in my presentation. So means I will try to cover, I will explain it, okay? So this is how we define, and there is one more that it's the same way that suppose there are so many means we want that we want to say that out of organization one, it's the same like R, that out of organization one member or two, same, it's same what we have defined here. There is an option that we can say that out of whatever the number we say, suppose I say two here, then it means and. So out of two means out of these organization, whatever the number is defined should endorse the transaction. So it's as it is here, it is written one. So it means we have to we have to mean it's the same like R. It's R. So if similarly, if we say that out of two out of these things, it's as I mentioned that this is and. And if we want this third one, that R out of two from all these. So it will be not exactly the same, but it will be either organization one or two, either organization one or three, either organization two or three. So it will be some like this. So we are saying that out of all three, all out of organization one, two, three member, two must endorse the policy. So it will be something like that. So to make it simple, to it will be difficult for us to write. And so to make it simple, so we have option that we can say that out of all these three, two must endorse this policy. So this is all about the endorsement policies. So let's go and practically see how we can do the let me first run my network. CD. Is theoretically everything clear? Whatever I.
Yeah, Munshi. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, so far so good. Thank you.
So during the exam that we will be they will be providing us this first network also, as I means then we will make it up. I will give my channel name, my channel. I want CouchDB, and I don't want any. So my network will be up and running. We are starting our first network that is provided in the fabric. So it will be creating two peer in organization one and two peer in organization. There will be two organization zero and organization one, and one of them and there will be two peer in each organization. So I have created the command. I have just copy paste this command. So I will be using the chain code, sample chain code SACC. That is provided here. So I will be creating the package first. Chain code package The name of my chain code is my chain code, and the path is here, and version is 1.1. As I mentioned, that ownership it will be taking from local MSP ID, and my policy is that organization 1.msp.admin. So I am saying that only admin of this organization should initiate this policy, and I am giving the output file name is ccpack.out. Let's see. Yes, it's up and running. Docker ps create docker. Let's dive in CLI. IT CLI bash clear. So let me copy this command. So this will create, if we see that ccpack.out, this package is created. So I think I haven't described. So after that, after this packaging, we can we have to create the package. We have to sign the package. A chain code package sign at the time at the creation can be handed over to owner of the inspection and signing. So I will see that. I don't see any much use here in 1.4, but in 2.0 it's much more so if you want, we have to sign the package, and it will be signing, and if we have multiple owner, then at the time of the endorsement it needs to be signed from each and every member. So what I will be, I just copy, this is simple command, that chain code package sign, whatever the file we have created just now, it will be signing this package, and it will be create the new file named sign CC pack, or whatever the name you give, it will be creating this signed package. So now our package is ready. So now we can start installation. PS chain code install. We can directly PR chain code install sign. So our package is successfully installed. We can check PR chain code list installed. So you can see that my chain code version. So it's same like we were giving the name and path through the install command. Now we have created the package and we have directly installed it. So let's create the command. So as my TLS is enabled in the network, we have to define a few environment variable. If we see that there are different variables, it's as I mentioned that this is local MSP ID is arg1.msp. TLS is enabled. If you see that we are in peer 0.0.org1. What I was saying in the initiation before doing this, what I will do, I will change the user, and I will change the user, and then we will try to initiate this. Let me change the user. MSP export core peer MSP config path. Let's first print it. Whatever. So admin of organization one. I print it echo dollar. So this can also help us during the exam, that we can see what exactly the. So if you see that admin of organization one is. So now what I'm doing, I'm changing the value to user. Export core peer MSP config path is equal to opt go path source, let me p-type apply the fabric peer crypto, then you have to go to peer organization one users. I will give user one MSP. Okay, now we have changed the user into CLI. This is how we change. Let me try to initiate this change code. So you can say that you can see this initiation policy violation. So if you are in another organization, if you are giving another admin, so you will be finding the same error, that initiation policy violation, because we have at the time of time of the signature signing the package, we have given the initiation policy that only admin one of organization can initiate this package. So let me again change the value export. Let me just directly go here and change the value MSP create. Oh, sorry, clear. Let's initiate. We have to give the whatever how we were doing the initiation. So we will be giving the same. It's the same way. Let's wait that it takes some time. So it will try to initiate this chain code, and we are providing the value. This is a sample chain code that will be setting the value of A. We have providing the value as 10. That's all. I hope it works. Let me grab. First, we will query this and okay. So we can see that it is. Let's check that. List plus 10 created. So this is a command. Okay, we have to provide the name of the channel. At what channel? My channel name is my channel. So let me clear and so we can see that this chain code has successfully initiated, and the version number is 1.0. So let me try to query the value of A. Let's see. It's 10, and let's change the value. Let's see if we can see. We have successfully changed the value. Let's query again. So now our chain code is up and running. So in this way, we can take the package and we can install this chain code and on each pair, and we can practice. So this is how this is what we have to do. The task we will first create the chain code. Create the package. Whatever the policy will be assigned to us, we have to assign. The policy, and we will create the package file. Then we will sign the package, and then we will be installing the chain code. And this is how we initiate. So this is a task. We have to install and initiate the chain code. This is a task will be assigned during the exam, and this is how we can do. And you can find this all these things as we will be able to access this documentation will be open. We don't need to remember each and every command because it's very tough, but we should know what exactly the way to initiate and install and initiate the package which we created. So by going through these steps, we will be able to complete the task. So now we have to before going to I have defined this whatever the endorsement policy I told explained that we can grab and we can define the endorsement policy. I will go this the last as I already did last time. So first we will be try to modify the chain code. Suppose if there is any change or some many other organizations are has been added in our network, so we need to upgrade this chain code. So how we can how we can upgrade this chain code? So the step will be almost same, except in at the time of initiation we have to provide the upgrade command. And for the upgradation we must know that our chain code must have the same name, and we just have to change the name of the version. We can give 2.0, we can give whatever we want, we can give 1.1 because we haven't done anything extra or anything. We are not going to change anything in the chain code for, but we are just trying to modify this chain code. So we see that how it works. So let me again grab this command. And is everything is there any question till now?
Yeah, Mohit Shankar. So that format of that package is that extension is .out, is right?
It's not important. I see that I haven't tried, but we will try to give even we can give the tar or any let's try. But I see in 2.0 it's tar. So
yeah,
it's star. So we will now we will try to change it. I think it it will not be a matter whatever exactly given. So let's it's good that we will try to give another name. I can give tar. Okay. Let's see. I haven't frankly speaking I haven't practiced as I was assigned this task yesterday. So I was just quickly finishing this. So let's try. Thank you. So what I'm giving the same name, my chain code, the path is same. I'm just giving this version is 1.1. And to just check that, we are giving to name, we are creating as a tar file. So let's see. Let's peer chain code, sign package. So we are giving the name. CC package to data, and I'm creating the tar file also. So we have this. Let's try to install this package peer chain code install sign. To data. Let's see. So it works. So whatever the name, it's just a file. It is just a file. Whatever name it's, it will be taking this, and it will be. Let's see. Peer chain code list installed. Sorry, this one. So we have now two chain codes installed on our this peer. The one is the older one and other one. Now let's try to, and if we go here, peer chain code, instantiate. Sorry, I always forget the name of the channel. We have to provide the name of the channel to see the list of the chain code. Let me clear it to make it so So we have this channel already initiated. Now we are trying to upgrade this. Before we were doing, so we have successfully installed. Now we are going to upgrade this chain code. And the only difference is before we were giving the instantiate command, now we will give the upgrade command. Here one thing we have to note that if you were in that session, that as we say that while writing the chain code, if we are trying to initialize our values, initialize our data. So currently, if we see that if I again query this chain code, if I try to query, so now we have changed the value of A as 20. Now currently the value of A is 20. This is just a sample. Whatever the data is initialized there, whatever the data is changed. So if we are initializing by, now if you see this command, what we are doing, we are again in the upgrade, we have to give the whatever the parameter we have defined during the initialization, we have to provide these parameters, or it will not work. So it's better to not to define, this is just a sample, it's okay, but what will be happening, it will override the value of 20 to 10 of A. So we have to be careful that we should not, it's a better practice, we should only initialize the variable that are required. It's just like a constructor in initialization. Whenever we initialize a class, we are overriding this method. So what we have to be careful while developing the chain code. So we should avoid doing that. This is just a point to note. Otherwise, we will be thinking that how we can upgrade this channel. But we at the same time, we don't want to, let's suppose we don't want the value of A to be overwritten. So currently, if you see that it will be overwrite, so it's better, means we need to be careful that whatever the initiation we have defined, so it will be overwrite. So but it's also important for us to, otherwise we will be doing manually, we will it's a single A, so we can do it, but practically, it means if you ask practically, it's not possible to do it. So this is just to mention that. Okay, let's see if I go now here, chain code list instantiated
channel.
I don't know what's wrong with me, but I always forget. So let me again clear to make it. So now before our chain code version was 1.0, now we have successfully upgraded our chain code and now it's 1.1. So this is successfully upgraded. Now let me query the value, it's 10. So as I mentioned this is what happened, and this task is done. This is how we can do the task of upgrade. These are the simple tasks that that almost cover the 20% of the certification. So we can practice, and we can see that definitely there will be not exactly as it is, but there will be they might ask us different endorsement policies or chain code initiation policy. Whatever, if we know the basic, then we will be good to go. Clear?
Yeah, Mulshankar.
Yes, okay, thank you. Okay, let's come to the last topic. I said that my last presentation will be available in day two on YouTube channel, so you can see the private data collection there. For private data collection, this is a way that we can, I will again explain that private data collection is the feature that was provided in IPL, means in one HLF 1.2. It is for the data security. Basically, we don't want to show the sensitive data to all our. We don't want our sensitive data to be available on all the peers or all the members of the organization. So we for this data security or privacy purpose, we only want the private data, like a personal data, like you can say pricing or anything that's person and personal that you don't want to share with anyone. Or maybe you have five organizations in your network, but you want that specific, suppose there is a data that is related to the government for auditing. So you only want that data only accessible by the government entity, not by other peers. So how we can do it? The one way is we can define the different channels. If there are many organizations, it will be headache. So Hyperledger has provided the feature of private data collection. So in this, we must use the private data collection for sensitive data. So for that, we have to, how we define that which data should be available for what. So while working on the private data collection, we have to define the collection policy. This is a JSON file. We have to define, this is a sample of JSON file, whatever there should be. It contains one or many policies, whatever the requirement of our organization or whatever the requirement of our use case, we have to define the collection policies. So I will be explaining that what exactly is a collection policy, what is in this file. Number one, we have to give the name of the policy that we will be, that the developer of this of the chain code will be using that policy name for writing the data or getting the private data. So these are the APIs. These are the methods to write or get the data, private data. We have to provide the same policy name, whatever the define in the collection policy JSON file. We will be using that collection policy name for that. Number second is the policy. So here, this is very important that we have to define that who is authorized for that, or which let me go down to say that here, this is the name of the policy. That let's see, this is an example of the collection marble that is provided in a fabric sample. You can see and find that. In the policy, we have to define with the R that which organization means this data, this private data will be available for whom. For whom? In this example, I will again say that if you have missed my last presentation, you can see. And suppose there was a example of marble, and in one policy, we were defining all the values of the marble except prices. We want that in that demo, we wanted to show the price only will be available for organization one member, but other data should be available for all. So we just to differentiate it, that we have created this sample policy that while writing the data for price, we use this policy name so that it will be available whatever we define here. The members will be available, the data will be available on only for those organizations. So in first policy, that was common. So we used the general policy that both organization one and organization two will have a data. So it's okay. But as we don't want to show the price for organization two member, or maybe you can say that purchasing price, we don't want to show. We only want to show the selling price. So we will be selling price, we will save using this policy. So being an admin, we have to just define the policy. Being a developer, that was a session. So being a, that suppose they say that we have to define the policy so that organization one should have this data and organization two have. So being admin, we will be defining the policy, and same policy will be used by the developer to write the data. So This is the second objective, this is very important. We have to define this policy. Then there is one other property, that is the required peer count. If you see, means required peer count, that this number of the peer required to disseminate the private data as a condition of the endorsement of the chain code. Here, this is a, just a number we have to provide. This is the integer value. We have to provide that. We have to provide the value for how many peer count should have the data, should disseminate the data, private data, how many number of the peers can disseminate the data. And for the the next is the maximum peer count. This is for the redundancy purpose. So we can say that how many how many number of peers this data will be distributed to. So suppose if we, it's not good that we give the name, if we give the name number zero. So if the endorsement peers goes down, these other peers will be available to requested to commit at the time of the commit to pull the private data. So we have to just give the number, that whatever, how many for the redundancy, how many the replication factor, you can say in the that how many numbers of the peers will be, the data will be replicated, how many the data will be available. The most important after policy is back to live, block to live, block to live. So this is the number that the data will be available only for these number of blocks, as we have done in the my previous, again sorry if I'm repeating my these words, that we have already done this, that I will explain you what exactly is. Suppose we want this, for what purpose this is the data. So as I mentioned, that this is the price, it will be available only for organization one peer. Suppose if we are giving here the block to live is 3, so after 3 block creation, this data will not be available for even organization one peer. Even organization one, after this 3 blocks, this data will not be available. If we are giving the number 3 block to live, means if we are giving the lifetime of this block, we are giving that how many time, how many blocks that data should reside. This is just a, suppose we are working for off-chain database. We want only the data for only for 3 times, so that we will be using this data as a off-chain database, maybe for data analytics, and we don't want to reside. We don't want this data forever. So we should be careful that giving this value, so that after 3, this data will not be, even the price will not be available for organization one peer. So this is very important property. So we have to, suppose we don't want to, this is called data purging. Data will be purged. If you see that data purging is, means data will not be available for only even for that authorized organization, it will be purged. So suppose if you don't want to purge your data, so you have to give the value 0. So it will be always there. So it again depends upon the use case. It again up to according to your need. But for the testing purpose, this was given to 3, so that we can test that after 3 blocks, we saw that the data was not available for that. The last thing, hello.
I see for the collection, the first one.
Sorry to interrupt you. I your voice is not clear. Can you please?
Okay. Is it clear now?
A bit better. Yes, tell me.
Okay, I was asking if the block to live, is there any way to tell the block to live is indefinite, like it can live forever? If we make 0 or minus 1, something like that?
No, yes, I told you, it's mentioned here also. If you don't want, see here, If you see that to keep the private data indefinitely, and you don't, it will be never purged. So you have to give the value zero.
Zero. Okay. Okay.
So if you give the value zero, so it will be never purged. So it will be forever. Okay. So this is option is available.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Welcome. So. Yes, option is there. So we should be, we should know that where what should be the value, so we can do whatever your requirement is. And the last, it was this property was available in 1.4 only. I somewhere heard that I somewhere read that there was some bug that before endorsement the data, private data, was even the unauthorized peer was able to see the data. So this is you can see that you can force that member only read, so it will be true. You have to provide the value true or false, as you we always give the truth, so that indicate that automatically enforce the that only clients belong to the collection members are allowed to read the private data. So this is how we define the collection policy. So you can go, and we are out of time. So you can go, and I will be sharing this link also on the group, as well as I can share through chat. So you can see, and we have already practiced this these things. So you can go and check how exactly it works, and while doing by your hand practically, so you will get more idea that what it is done. So. Yes, this is all from my side for today. I try to explain the first part of the certification. So it is as per the documentation, it is the 20%. Definitely there will be difference. So we can go in the next phase. We can go in, that is the install and configure the network. That's also very important. So somebody like Pavan or anybody can go. These are the topic we have to cover in next sessions. So you can take any of these topics, or you so you can take, and you are most welcome to talk. Maybe somebody can talk that how we can configure the raft. This is very simple also, how to modify the word state database as a configuration. Word is modify the word state database configuration, how we can change from LevelDB to CouchDB. It is very simple way, a simple exercise you can do yourself also. Okay, let me know if you have any question regarding this. Oh, I will.
I have one. For the ordering service.
Sorry?
I was wondering if for the ordering service, the question are based on Kafka or on...
Sorry, I think I had a problem, or you guys are facing, you are able to...
Yeah, I think we are getting a lot of echo. Actually, we are getting a lot of echo. Just, can you just bit little closer to the mic so that we get a clear voice?
Yeah, I have... a headset, so the mic is close to my mouse.
Okay, we will try to focus on your question, please.
The question was, is if the raft, the consent, the ordering service is on raft or on Kafka, Apache Kafka. Because it's the certification is based on the 1.4 version of Ecology Fabric.
1.4.1.
Okay, so the question are not about Raft, about Kafka anymore. It's about Kafka.
Yes, I practice Kafka, but now I can see it's Raft there. So
it means, so I don't have to practice Kafka.
I think we should practice both, but as they mention Raft, so there will be Raft only.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Okay, yes, come to the previous questions. I will try to, can you please explain again, because I forgot the name. Uh, Hello. Hello. Okay, I think yes. If you, I don't know. I while presentation there was some question. So if we can try to. If you have any question, we can have. We can. We are out of time now. So we can. I will try to answer if you ask on the group select channel. I hope everyone of you are available there, so you can join and we can. I will try to answer this question there also. Okay, thank you everybody. Yeah. Have a nice day you. Ahead. Okay. Thank you so much,
Mulsankar. Thank you so much for this
awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you all.